Hi everyone, this is Neil DeGalorians, the Archivist-in-Residence here at the Lucinia Historical Society with another Archivist update. As you can see, I'm wearing my Pride glasses because happy Pride, which turns out to be apropos. This week's update does not add much to the supernatural elements of the story, however, it does give us a little bit more insight on who these people were. So the fifth letter is from Cyrus to Nicholas. It's very short. It basically just says he's dropping everything he's doing to visit Nicholas. I have the full transcript on the website, but clearly he's concerned. And that ends up making a ton of sense contextually. So going to the sixth letter, the thing you'll notice first is just how tightly folded up it is. It is not folded in half like the other letters. And so when we open it up, we actually find ourselves something very interesting. So I'm just going to read it to you in its entirety. My darling Cyrus, please forgive this intrusion. I can imagine after sharing the same bed for a week, little is left to the imagination of who the other is. How deeply I've missed the feeling of your skin on mine, embracing you in such a way where I melt into you. I cannot imagine you will find this impatient scribbling of mine until your next trip, when you plan on using this suitcase again, but I hope it will not take so long. This note is to remind you who you are. You are my anchor. You're what keeps me from drifting from shore into the uncertain tides and monstrous unknowns. You were correct in surmising my loneliness and research led to a paranoid dread that haunted me in the form of those accursed pink-hued visions. The moment your arms wrapped around me, I felt the entirety of my soul returning to my body. I collapsed into you. You held me as I wept. Not a single word had been uttered between us. And I knew in that moment, you are my home. And I am lost without you. When your lips met mine, I finally knew how I need you, how I need to breathe. You are an oasis in the desert, quenching me and granting me shade from the harsh and unforgiving sun. I lose myself in my work, so I may once again find myself in you. Perhaps this is unhealthy, but I am forever grateful that you've decided to keep a hold of me after all this time. I am writing this as you sleep next to me. I pray you do not wake early and ruin the surprise. You are leaving me today, but I know it is not forever. I have faith I will see you again, and I shall count every single second until I do. Eternally your boy, Nicholas. So, on one hand, their queerness is confirmed. It turns out my shipping was correct all along. It's hard for me to be really excited about this, though. Getting a little personal, Nicholas reminds me a lot of myself. And even this relationship between the two reminds me of my relationship with my husband. We actually used to do similar things, hiding notes in each other's luggage when we were living long distance from each other. And without getting into it, we're kind of in a similar situation right now. But also, Nicholas reminds me in the sense that I bury myself in my work. He's this researcher or scholar or whatever who devotes way too much of his life into his work to the point of harming his relationships. And unfortunately, I find that pretty relatable. Thankfully, I'm not hallucinating this like pink miasma haunting me everywhere I go, so... Another reason why it's hard for me to be really happy about this is knowing what it was like to be queer in the 19th century. So it's not exactly easy being queer in the 21st century either, but in Ohio, sodomy laws were passed in 1885, which criminalized a lot of consensual sexual activity, most importantly that between men having sex with other men. Interestingly, lesbians were not considered to be queer, or rather, sex between two women was not considered to be sinful. This letter brings up another question that I've been asking myself this whole time is why the society has these letters in their collection. There's definitely significance with the Laura Pruden connection from last time. There's some historical spiritualist significance there. I can also maybe understand that keeping the entire collection is just for the sake of completion. It's interesting because I keep trying to find more information about these men and nothing is coming up. So it seems like these really were just everyday people that had no major significant impacts on their societies or the world that they lived in. It also feels a little weird digging into these, and it's making me question just the ethics of looking into personal letters, looking into diaries, things like that. In retrospect, it seems so exploitative and invasive to do that. But at the end of the day, we're getting a really interesting insight on 19th century life in Ohio. So I really need to just kind of step away from that. And I want to end off this update with a bit of a studio update, as well as a pretty exciting thing to look forward to. Hopefully soon I'll have a finished video animation with my final draft of the sound. I'm getting really close to, I think, accomplishing what was first described in that original letter. And more excitingly, I've been given permission by Dr. Salove to do a séance. So I've been using this 1918 book written anonymously titled How to Speak to the Dead, a Practical Handbook. You can actually find the full book online through the Internet Archive, but there are also a handful of contemporary editions printed. And what's fascinating about the book is that it lays out a very practical way to hold a séance by yourself. So later tonight, I'll be recording that, and with any luck, something fascinating happens, and if not, we'll just ignore I ever said anything. So hopefully the next time I see you, I'll be in my house doing something spooky and talking to a dead person. Until then, see you next time.